Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. No deal. The White House and congressional Democrats so far fail to reach an agreement on the next round of economic aid as American deaths from COVID top 160,000. Then, feeling the pain, the U.S. unemployment rate fell in July, but millions of Americans are still out of work and struggling to get by.
I have been fighting for unemployment for the weeks that I did not work, rather the months that I did not work, and I have still yet to get money for that. It has taken us down to zero.
And it's Friday. Mark Shields and David Brooks assess the debate over coronavirus spending and the upcoming political conventions. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
the Women's Suffrage Centennial Commission. Honoring 100 years of the 19th Amendment, landmarks will light up in purple and gold on August 26 for the Forward Into Light campaign. Learn more at womensvote100.org.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Financial services firm Raymond James. Johnson & Johnson.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Negotiations on more COVID financial relief have stalled in Washington tonight amid signs that the economic recovery has stalled as the virus surges again. According to the Labor Department, employers added a net of 1.8 million jobs in July. That's far fewer than the previous 2 months. The unemployment rate did fall nearly a full percent to 10.2%, but that is still higher than during the Great Recession. Against that backdrop, White House negotiators and Democratic congressional leaders failed again to agree on a relief package, possibly including federal jobless benefits that expired a week ago. Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi met with Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin and White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows. They spoke afterward at the Capitol.
We're asking them, again, to be fair, to meet us in the middle, not to have a my way or the highway attitude, which they seem to have.
Anyway, but I've told them, come back when you are ready to give us a higher number.
We will continue to try to get an agreement that's in the best interest of the people, and that's why we're here.
But in the meantime, we're going to take executive orders to try to alleviate some of the pain that people are experiencing. This is not a perfect answer. We'll be the first ones to say that, but it is all that we can do.
And here with the latest on these negotiations are our own Lisa Desjardins and Yamiche Alcindor. So hello to both of you. And Lisa, to you first, what is known about what they actually were able to negotiate or discuss behind closed doors? And what do we know about what the main sticking points are?
Right. A little bit more on what you just reported, Judy. Democrats offered to take down their offer about $1 trillion to the $2 trillion area, let's say. But Republicans said that really what Democrats were doing was changing the timeline of spending. Some spending that Democrats wanted to have for 2 years, they would say limit, or sorry, they wanted 3 years, and Democrats were moving it to 2 years. Essentially, Judy, Republicans said they don't think it's real money. They didn't see a real change in sort of the items that Democrats were asking for. Nonetheless, Democrats said they've made what they believe is a good faith offer. They are now waiting for Republicans to make the next move.
And Yamiche, we heard the White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows say that the president is prepared to take action unilaterally on his own. What is known about how the White House sees the way forward now?
Well, the White House has taken the stance that Democrats are not taking these negotiations seriously. That, of course, is something that Democrats disagree with. I want to read to you a tweet that the president sent just in the last hour. He wrote, "Pelosi and Schumer are only interested in bailout money for poorly run Democrat cities and states. Nothing to do with the virus. Want $1 trillion, no interest. We are going a different way." That different way, Judy, is the executive action that you just alluded to. The president, I'm told from White House officials, is looking at several different options, including a payroll tax initiative, something to do with student loans, some sort of movement on unemployment benefits, as well as some sort of movement on eviction protections. Today was a self-imposed deadline for the White House to move forward on its own and look only to doing executive actions. I should note that the White House is saying that they feel like they're going to be on firm legal ground when it comes to this executive order, but Democrats disagree and say a lot of the things that the president wants to do, he simply cannot do only by executive order.
So amid this impasse over coronavirus relief, there were also some new developments today on another major issue, the security of this November's elections. A top U.S. intelligence official, William Evanina, released a statement that details the intelligence community's current assessment of potential foreign interference. Evanina raised concern about the ongoing and potential activity by China, Russia, and Iran. On Chinese influence, he said intelligence agencies assess that China prefers that President Trump, whom Beijing sees as unpredictable, does not win re-election, and that Russia is using a range of measures to primarily denigrate former Vice President Biden. In a follow-up statement, the two leaders of the Senate Intelligence Committee, that's Republican Marco Rubio and Democrat Mark Warner, said that they, quote, encourage political leaders on all sides to refrain from weaponizing intelligence matters for political gain. So that's a lot to swallow late this afternoon. But Lisa, let me pick up with that. What do we see in this statement from the intelligence community that adds to what we already knew about the possibility of foreign interference in our election?
Talking to Hill sources, they point out that Evanina is not seen as political, but as someone who is almost an American patriot, a longtime civil servant. They also say this, Judy, Democrats say there's a difference between what China's doing and what Russia's doing, that Russia is acting on their capabilities more than China, Russia acting to take down Vice President Biden. One other note, Judy, though, both parties are worried that the American public's not ready for what may be ahead.
And Yamiche, in terms of the White House, what are they saying about this? Are they saying that they plan to take any particular steps to address it?
The White House today, officials tell me, are really focused on making sure that our elections are safe. They say they're not going to tolerate any sort of foreign interference and that they're working with all 50 states as well as social media companies to keep the election safe. That said, President Trump has been loath to talk about election interference. First in 2016 when intelligence community said that Russia was interfering on his behalf, and now in 2020 when they say Russia is doing the same thing. The president instead has been focused on mail-in voting and saying that there's widespread fraud there, even though there is no evidence of that. So Democrats and critics of the president say he's not focused enough on this issue.
All right. Well, it certainly has raised a lot of questions, and I know both of you are going to continue to follow that as well as these the path forward on these negotiations over COVID relief. Thank you, Yamiche Alcindor, Lisa Desjardins. Thank you.
Sure thing.
In the day's other news, the death toll from the massive Beirut port explosion reached 154, with more than 5,000 hurt. More bodies were found today as French rescue teams and others searched the area. With that operation underway, the head of the powerful Hezbollah militia insisted that his Iranian-backed group is not to blame.
I wholeheartedly deny that there is anything that belongs to us in the port. No warehouse for weapons, rockets, no guns, no bombs, no bullets, no nitrate, nothing. Absolutely. Not now and not in the past. Never.
Lebanon's president, Michel Aoun, vowed to investigate all possible causes. An Air India Express passenger jet crashed and broke in two today, trying to land in heavy rain in southern India. At least 16 people were killed and more than 120 hurt. Doctors and rescuers worked through bad weather to reach survivors. The 190-passenger flight carried people who had been stranded abroad by the pandemic. Britain says that it will crack down on a wave of migrants crossing the English Channel from France. Authorities yesterday picked up at least 235 people in small boats. That is a one-day record. More migrants were found at sea today. British officials say organized smuggling and good summer weather are behind the increase. China has fired back after President Trump banned U.S. companies from doing business with the Chinese owners of WeChat and TikTok. New executive orders could bar distribution of the social media apps within the U.S. in 45 days. Mr. Trump charges that they shared data with the Chinese government. But Beijing says that the accusation is baseless.
Under the pretext of national security, the U.S. frequently abuses its state power and unjustifiably cracks down on non-U.S. companies. This is a blatant act of bullying, and China is firmly opposed to it.
Also today, the U.S. imposed economic sanctions on Carrie Lam. She's the pro-Beijing leader of Hong Kong. She's accused of helping implement a tough new Chinese security law in the city. A federal appeals court in Washington says House Democrats may pursue a fight to subpoena former White House counsel Don McGahn. They want to know whether President Trump tried to obstruct the Russia probe. The White House argues that McGahn has legal immunity. Today's ruling revives the Democrats' lawsuit, but there is little time to resolve the issue before the current Congress ends in January. Jerry Falwell Jr. is taking an indefinite leave of absence as president and chancellor of Liberty University. The evangelical Christian school in Virginia issued a terse statement this afternoon. In recent days, Falwell apologized over photos he posted online. One showed his pants unzipped and his arm around a young woman. Wall Street struggled to make headway today as investors pored over the July jobs report. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 46 points to close at 27,433. The Nasdaq fell 97 points, and the S&P 500 added 2. And Brent Scowcroft has died. He was the only person to serve as national security advisor in two administrations. His first stint came under President Gerald Ford in 1975. He served again under President George H.W. Bush 14 years later. Scowcroft helped fashion U.S. policy on the end of the Cold War, the first Gulf War, and other critical events. And he remained a close observer of the world. In 2011, he talked with Jim Lehrer on the NewsHour about online organizing in the Arab Spring protests.
Now, the world is politicized. For most of our history, the average man didn't know what was going on in anything other than his own village, and he didn't care much. Now, everybody's within eyesight of a TV or earshot of a radio. They hear what's going on.
Or one of those little...
That's right, little whatever. Instruments. And they're activated by it.
Brent Scowcroft was 95 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, Americans struggle financially as unemployment claims top 1 million for the 20th straight week. Ohio's Republican Governor Mike DeWine discusses the ongoing response to the coronavirus. an unexpectedly contentious election in Belarus could mean the end for a president known as Europe's last dictator, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The economy is getting back some of the jobs lost during the start of the pandemic and the shutdowns that followed. But as we reported at the top of the program, that job growth seems to be slowing. Millions still don't have work yet, and many have lost financial aid and benefits. Given both of those problems, we wanted to hear from viewers about what you're dealing with right now. Here's what some of you told us.
So my name is Darren Hart.
My name is Amy Scheid.
My name is Jason Williams.
My name is Antonio Cruz Martinez.
My name is Deanna Coral Hall.
The extra $600 in unemployment benefits was extremely helpful. I was able to spend a little extra on some groceries, you know, get a little bit more food to have.
The standard unemployment wasn't going to cover our household bills. But then when they gave us the extra $600 a week, that didn't replace my entire salary, but it was really, really close to what I made after taxes.
I own a catering company and bistro. We spend every moment trying to figure out how to make this dream stay alive and how to come out of it in a way where we will eventually be able to retire. It's been emotionally exhausting.
I have been fighting for unemployment for the weeks that I did not work, rather the months that I did not work, and I have still yet to get money for that. It has taken us down to zero. All of our accounts are zero now.
I've been a DTA for about 10 years. I haven't received any federal COVID relief funds or any funds of any sort. And I don't even know where to start as a gig worker, like on how to get money. The wait line for the unemployment is just so long. And having to sell things is one of the things that I've unfortunately had to resort to, which is ultimately very heartbreaking.
The extra $600 it ended July 31st. And my lease agreement is up August 31st. I've had to decide to move back in with my mom, which luckily she is totally fine with that, but it still is stressful because I don't know, you know, what's next.
The extra unemployment has been, it's been awesome. But if that goes too far down, we'd definitely be back underwater.
The kinds of conversations that we've had to engage in since this began, both with customers and with staff and family, I have to come home, take a minute, breathe, steel myself, and then dial that phone and hang up and sob.
If I don't find something like within the next, I guess, 5 to 6 months, then I will have nothing left.
It's like, okay, I'm down to my change jars now, and I'm going to have to cash my change jars in. I'm going to have to recycle the metal that's sitting in my yard. I'm just worried that I'm not going to have enough money to just survive. It's not even to be able to do anything extra.
Let's hear about the fallout of all this and how it is playing in the heartland from the governor of Ohio, Mike DeWine. He tested negative for the coronavirus last night, just hours after testing positive. And Governor, we're glad to know that you did test negative. And I want to ask you about testing in just a moment, but let's start with the economy and employment, because we do have new unemployment numbers out today. They did slightly improve this past month, but overall, as you just heard, a lot of Americans still feeling very stressed. Tell us what you're hearing from Ohioans about the jobs picture and unemployment.
Well, we have some people like those that you just interviewed who, you know, very worried. They're worried about paying the rent. You know, when we look at our state revenues that are coming in, one of the things that our economists say is that it's clear that this money, that Congress, extra money, extra unemployment money, you know, was very valuable for the individuals who got it. And it was also, frankly, very valuable for the economy and for other people. So it had a real ripple effect that people spent it and that it really was very, very significant. So we hope Congress comes up with a compromise here and get something done.
Governor, let's talk about your test. As we said, you first tested positive yesterday, then negative, and I understand you're going to have another test tomorrow. What does this experience, though, tell you about the state of testing right now in this country?
Well, you know, Judy, the second test I had, which is kind of the gold standard, is the test that almost every one of your viewers who are watching this, at least those from Ohio, have gotten. About 1.3 million Ohioans have been tested. Over 90% have been this particular type of test. So the first test I took was a quick test. And not all quick tests are the same, but this is an antigen test. I'm not a scientist, but what they tell me is that you're basically, they're measuring the protein, which is on the coronavirus itself. And they're not as reliable. I'm told they're roughly 70% reliable. Usually, if it's wrong, it's a false negative. I guess I'm one of the strange ones. I got a false positive. But the test that we took yesterday at Ohio State afterwards, and then they ran it twice, and my wife was tested as well. That really is the gold standard. It's what most people, the test most people have received. I think all the states are really looking at, you know, how do we improve the testing, but how do we ramp this testing up? And this antigen test may play a role. We're looking at it to see maybe how we can use it. But you have to accept the fact that you get a quick result, but the result is not nearly as reliable as, you know, it would be in a diagnostic test.
Well, I know you and five other governors have just come together to sign, I guess, a kind of a compact where you're going to work together, pool your resources to try to ramp up testing in all five or six of these states. But here we are, Governor, we are more than 6 months into when the first case of COVID was discovered in the United States, and we still are behind on testing. Should something have been done sooner at the national level or in some nationally coordinated way to get us to a better place than we are right now?
Well, Judy, we all wish we had more testing. It's been a problem for most states, maybe all states. We've lagged behind in testing, frankly. We've never been a state that was red hot. So the priorities has never been towards Ohio. And we like it that way in the sense we don't want to be red hot. But we need more testing in Ohio. Now, we've tripled the testing in Ohio. We're averaging now about 23,000 tests a day. Frankly, we need to double it again, and then we probably need to double it after that. So we're moving. We're trying to grow some of our own in the sense of expanding our labs in Ohio, try to own some of that. We're also reaching out to a lot of different companies. The market is starting to move finally. More companies are offering different types of tests that are out there. But, you know, the lesson, I think, from what happened with me is we got to be careful. We got to make sure we got reliable tests. And we got to try to get our time down. It's two things: get our tests back quicker, and also get more tests and more capacity. That plus the social distancing and wearing the mask. Those are the three things: the mask, the social distancing, and the quicker tests and get those tests back. That's the key to us being able to go out and resume our lives. I tell people that's freedom. The masks are freedom. Social distancing gives us freedom, and these tests give us freedom.
And, Governor, there have been a couple of in-depth reports that have been published in the last few days looking at why the United States, with all of our resources and all of our wealth, is one of the worst countries on the planet with regard to COVID. And it points to mistakes made in the beginning and throughout. What do you look to here? You said a moment ago you don't want to spend a lot of time looking back, but should Washington, should the leadership at the national level have been more forceful in taking this seriously and getting people to respond and pouring more resources into it?
Judy, I think there's a couple big lessons that we need to take away from this. One lesson is we have to invest in public health. Democrats and Republicans alike have not invested in public health the way we should. We've got to do it at the national level. We've got to do it at the state level. And we've got to be committed to that for the long run. And the other, of course, long-term lesson is we can't rely on other countries to manufacture all our products that we need in regard to medical care. We've got to make more of them right here in the United States.
And finally, Governor, very quickly, presidential election, President Trump was in Ohio yesterday talking about the campaign. Among other things, he spoke about Joe Biden, said that Joe Biden is against the Bible, against God, that he wants to hurt God. Is this the kind of message that you think is the path to victory for the president?
I think the path to victory is for the president to, you know, to focus on the basic things. You know, the president, until this coronavirus came along, our economy was doing well. I'm optimistic. We get this thing behind us, we're going to see our economy flip back. I think the president needs to talk about that, his vision there. You know, for those of us who are more conservative, we're very happy with his court appointments to not just the Supreme Court, but to the circuit court and the district courts. I think those are some of the things that, you know, the president will focus on.
We're going to leave it there. Governor Mike DeWine of Ohio. And again,
thanks, Judy.
Glad that test came back negative. Thank you.
Thanks, Judy.
On Sunday, voters in Belarus head to the polls in the most contested election there in decades. President Alexander Lukashenko has been called Europe's last dictator. He has led Belarus with an iron fist for 26 years, accused of human rights abuses, stifling dissent, and running sham elections. But he now faces an unprecedented challenge. And as Nick Schifrin reports, the opposition is led by women who have taken up the mantle of resistance.
Привет, Минск!
In Belarus, behind every good man is a better woman, in this case, three of them. Veronika Tsepkala, Maria Kolesnikova, and Svetlana Tsekhanouskaya, three women who just a few months ago were in the background, now saluted as superheroes, taking on Europe's longest-serving leader.
The government got rid of strong candidates, but they didn't know. Every strong man has a strong woman that supports him.
37-year-old Tsekhanouskaya was a former English teacher and homemaker who was married to an opposition politician running for president when he was arrested in May in broad daylight. Now, as a presidential candidate herself, Tsekhanouskaya is trying to turn her husband's moment into a movement with the help of Kolesnikova, who managed the campaign of another opposition candidate before he was arrested, and Tsepkala, who managed the campaign of her husband, an opposition candidate forced to flee the country with their children. Together, they've helped inspire the largest protests in decades and called for a national reckoning.
As long as I can remember, I have been living a lie, this endless lie. I want this lie to finally end.
I am tired of being patient. I'm tired of being silent. I am tired of being afraid. And you? Are you tired of being patient?
The three of them together have just mobilized the Belarusian people like we've never seen before.
Matthew Rajansky directs the Wilson Center's Kennan Institute. He says the government's targeting the original male opposition candidates helped crystallize longstanding anger.
They became political martyrs, being arrested, being pushed out of the country. That was obviously a slap in the face of the Belarusian people. Time when you run this kind of, you know, a tight-fist authoritarian regime and you leave no room for dissent, no room for people to voice their opposition in a meaningful way, you know, almost any pressure release valve is going to get a lot of pressure coming through it.
Alexander Lukashenko took power in 1994, only 3 years after the country's independence from the Soviet Union. He was elected on a platform of anti-corruption. But his critics called him a European dictator, rigging elections and enabling widespread graft. For months, protesters sick and tired of authoritarian governance and a weak economy wielded slippers to squash a president they called a cockroach. Police responded in force. Plainclothes officers detained journalists and activists and made widespread arrests. Last week, authorities also arrested Russian mercenaries, accusing them of terrorist attacks to destabilize Belarus. But days later, Lukashenko promised allegiance to Moscow.
Russia has always been and will always be our closest ally, no matter who is in power in Belarus or Russia.
COVID has further eroded public trust. Belarus has one of Europe's highest per capita infection rates. Lukashenko eventually tested positive, but at first he called the virus a psychosis and said it was treatable with vodka and saunas. And at a crowded hockey game, he denied its existence.
I don't understand. There are no viruses here. Did you see any of them flying around?
Individual Belarusians came to the rescue.
We try to survive. We are really interesting. We help each other.
Anna Gorchakova is the director of the Belarusian Children's Hospice. She contracted COVID and told me conditions in the hospital were so bad she had to help other patients. Civil society groups like #BuyCovid19 prepared meals for poorly supplied healthcare workers and gathered supplies for overwhelmed hospitals. The shortages cemented anger at an ineffective government.
And now is the time to think who I am, what I want. I'm ready to change country. I'm ready to change health system.
Early voting's already underway. And despite the opposition's momentum, Lukashenko controls the election apparatus and is expected to be declared the winner. The extent of protests will determine what comes next.
If you have tens of thousands of people pouring into the streets in Minsk and in the major cities across Belarus, that's when I might expect him to turn out the Belarusian paratroops and the Belarusian riot police en masse.
Whether or not it's the end of the line for Lukashenko, for Belarusians, there's hope in the first real alternative in decades. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
Yesterday marked 75 years since the atomic bombing of Hiroshima, Japan. The attack shocked the world, but it would be another year before Americans would get firsthand accounts from people who lived through it, thanks to trailblazing reporting by New Yorker writer John Hersey. Author Leslie Bloom has a new book about Hersey and how his reporting exposed the bomb's lasting damage, which the U.S. government tried initially to downplay. And she spoke with Jeffrey Brown as part of our continuing coverage of this solemn anniversary. This is also part of our arts and culture series, Canvas.
August 6, 1945. The future of warfare and humanity itself would change when the U.S. detonated a single atomic bomb over Hiroshima, Japan. But while everyone saw the mushroom cloud, it would be a year before the world fully understood what had happened on the ground that day. A story told in the pages of the New Yorker magazine by journalist John Hersey.
We know what the aftermath of nuclear warfare looks like because John Hersey showed us.
In her new book, Fallout, author Leslie Bloom explores how Hersey came to write a profoundly influential work. She calls it one of the most important works of journalism ever created. That has shaped generations since.
Even if people, his eventual readers, could not understand the physics that went into the nuclear bomb, they could certainly relate to the stories of six regular people.
The bomb in Hiroshima, followed days later by one destroying Nagasaki, led to Japan's surrender and ecstatic celebrations of a hard-earned American victory. The U.S. government justified use of these experimental weapons as necessary to end the war. But, Bloom writes, covered up the bomb's horrifying impact on humans, including the after effects of radiation.
On the one hand, they wanted to showcase the might of their weapon because they now had a weapon that nobody else did. But on the other hand, they didn't want to reveal the true devastation of the bomb, and also reveal the fact that it was a weapon that went on killing long after detonation in a really gruesome way.
Hersey was just 31, but already a veteran war correspondent.
He had seen the worst of human nature, and he felt that at the end of what remains the deadliest conflict in human history, the only way that human civilization had a chance at surviving is if we began to see the humanity in each other again.
He was also a writer. His 1944 novel, A Bell for Adano, won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction. Working with legendary New Yorker editors Harold Ross and William Shawn, Hersey proposed a novelistic approach. Tell the intersecting stories of six individuals who'd crossed paths that day.
A lot of the reporting that had been done on the major devastation caused by the bombs, it was rendered in a very, you know, eye of God kind of way. You know, this is the end of days, and you were just seeing massive roiling mushroom clouds. And so what Hersey decided to do was to dial it back from a sort of a point of view of God narrative to the point of view of six regular folks on the ground.
The subjects included two doctors, two clergy, a widow caring for three children, and a young clerk. The humanizing style is there from the famous first line. At exactly 15 minutes past 8 in the morning on August 6, 1945 Japanese time, at the moment when the atomic bomb flashed above Hiroshima, Miss Toshiko Sasaki, a clerk in the personnel department of the East Asia Tin Works, had just sat down at her place in the plant office and was turning her head to speak to the girl at the next desk.
And, you know, instead of being, you know, incinerated on the spot, she was almost crushed by falling bookshelves and was covered in books. And when Hersey met her and heard her story, he found himself thinking that it was incredibly ironic that this life was nearly taken by books in the first moments of the atomic age. And even when he was still in Hiroshima, he knew that he was going to write about that in his own article.
That article would take up the entire issue of The New Yorker on August 31st, 1946, and would itself become a bombshell, capturing headlines around the world. In book form, it has sold more than 3 million copies to date. There's much more to the tale Bloom tells, including the surprising role of General Leslie Groves, one of the leaders of the Manhattan Project who tried to suppress information about the bomb, but then saw benefits to Hersey's reporting. And years later, a bizarre appearance by one of Hersey's subjects, Reverend Kiyoshi Tanimoto, on an episode of This Is Your Life.
They trotted out not only people from his life, but they even trotted out one of the bombers from the Enola Gay, who had bombed Hiroshima and forced a meeting between the two gentlemen. And it's some pretty skin-crawling stuff, for sure.
John Hersey donated part of the proceeds from his work to the American Red Cross. He didn't return to Japan for 40 years, wrote many more books, and died in 1993.
It's been argued that that article and then the book afterwards played an important role in the fact that nuclear weapons have not been used since. Do you believe that?
Well, John Hersey definitely believed that. A lot of people don't realize how perilous the nuclear landscape is right now. The Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, which has its famous doomsday clock, has now set it closer to midnight, i.e. nuclear apocalypse, than it has ever been since its advent in the late 1940s. One of the things that John Hersey was especially worried about by the time the Cold War accelerated again in the 1980s was that the memory of Hiroshima was fading. And if you didn't have the memory as a deterrent anymore, was it going to be as potent a deterrent? And I think that remains a really crucial question today.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown.
And now we turn to the weekly political analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Hello to both of you. So, David, let's start by looking at what hasn't happened between the White House and Republicans and the Democrats in the Congress on what kind of, if any, relief to continue to offer Americans in this pandemic. I guess the evidence couldn't be any plainer. More than 30 million Americans are out of work, but still no agreement. What do you make of it?
You know, every sort of system in this country failed during the COVID. And one thing didn't fail, and that was Congress. Congress actually got some money out the door, and it's for one part of our system worked, and now it's not working. And it's going to apparently go to the White House with executive orders, which is a disaster on two levels. On the first level, it's a breakdown of our democracy. We have a strong congressional system where the Congress is supposed to spend the money, and that isn't working, apparently. Second, you just can't do that much with an executive order. We've got, you know, 10% unemployment. We've got whole industries shut down. There's just not a lot that Donald Trump can do without Congress.
And we're hearing, Mark, that we may be just moments away from the president talking in a news conference at 7 o'clock Eastern about what he proposes to do. We're not sure what that is, but here we are, as David said, and they've been talking for days and days. The House passed a legislation back in May, and here we are in August, and there's nothing. Why?
Well, Judy, obviously it's not going to be of any political advantage to either party to stalemate in Washington. But I think that the truth has to be addressed, and that is that the Democrats did pass a plan. They do have a plan. They do have a united position, and there is no Republican plan. I mean, it's a repeat of health care. There is no Republican plan. The president, the author of The Art of the Deal, has been missing. He hasn't even participated. And Mitch McConnell, in a moment of burst of candor, said that he did not have the votes. He would have to pass anything with Democratic votes. That's the political reality of it. David's right. The legislative process is infinitely preferable to executive orders. I mean, it just is. This is no answer. But I mean, that is the political reality of the situation.
But David, you know, we're not in the room. We don't know what exactly is being said. But the Democrats report they've offered to cut their $3 trillion down to two. They're cut it by a trillion and say, is there some way to find compromise? They are saying the Republicans said no to that. Why can't they get something done, I guess, is my question.
Yeah, well, the Republicans have the $1 trillion apparently on the table, and why they just couldn't split the math is a bit of a mystery. But I guess there are two things. A lot of Republicans are worried about deficits. A lot of Republicans are worried that if you give people a lot of money, they're not going to go back to work, something economic studies have not found so far. I guess what's missing is an underlying analysis, an economic analysis of how much we need. And I'm not sure we need 3.4. Some economists think we only need $1 trillion right now. And so the numbers seem to be untied to the level of need. What's clear, though, is that we are in the midst of a tremendous economic crisis. The idea that the crisis is over is not true, and that this is a time to err on the side of largeness. But why they just can't split the difference is a mystery to me.
And Mark, who will pay a political price, or will anybody pay a political price for this?
Well, I think when people start suffering, and there are graphic evidence thereof of people without shelter, children going hungry in this country, then it will come back to the president and his administration, because in the final analysis, he is the single national leader. And so in that sense, it will redound to the detriment or disadvantage of the Republicans. But, you know, it's a human tragedy we're talking about, Judy. It really is. And it's one that the president is ill-fitted for. Donald Trump is talking about optimistic projections, opening schools, returning to work. And that isn't his stock and trade. His stock and trade is doom and gloom. He's a 5 minutes to midnight Republican, not a 5 minutes to sunrise Republican like Reagan or Jack Kemp. Unlike Bill Clinton, who had a great gift for empathy, for actually feeling the pain of citizens with problems, Donald Trump has translated into this is a great disadvantage to me. And it's my pain, and I'm feeling it. I really think, you know, he's headed for political disaster, but more important, a public tragedy.
And David, as we've been reporting today, there was some, yes, the unemployment rate has dropped, but the number of new jobs being added is not as much as it had been. This recovery seems to be slowing. What do we see in terms of leadership, either from the president or anyone else, that is going to pull the country through this? The pandemic is continues to rage around the country.
It's weirdly a failure of political opportunism. It's clearly in Donald Trump's interest to get federal money out the door and get the economy going in the fall so he can claim the economy's coming back. And so he's not doing what's in his clear political interest, probably because the party has convinced itself right now that deficits are more important than the immediate crisis. That goes to a larger failure, the Republicans. For decades, political psychologists have said Republicans are different from Democrats because Republicans have a sense of menace. They're quicker to perceive threat. That has not happened. In this case of COVID, whether it's economic or health-wise, the decades of political psychology have totally been turned on their head. And they've been turned on their head for one reason: Donald Trump. He's the one who decided it wasn't a severe threat, either economically or physically, and the Republican Party has followed him. It's a lesson in how powerful partisanship is, that the basic psychology of a movement can suddenly change if one leader says change.
Judy, if I...
Mark, go ahead.
I just wanted to pick up on David's point. It's obvious to me that the Republicans think the Democrats are going to win in November. Why do I say that? Because the only time, history, check it out, the only time that Republicans talk about deficits is when there's a Democrat in the White House. They've just coming off 4 years of Republican control, and what did they do? They ran up the deficit in a time of incredible national prosperity, of low national unemployment. They increased the national deficit, the annual deficit, and the national debt. But now, the prospect of Joe Biden and the Democrats taking over, deficits become a moral issue to the Republicans. Little hypocrisy here, maybe.
So, David, speaking of Joe Biden, the Democratic National Convention, such as it is going to start about 10 days from now, a week from Monday. We've learned that not only that no major speakers, including Joe Biden himself, are not even going to Milwaukee. It's going to be a convention like nothing we've ever seen before. The Republican National Convention, the president has said he may give his acceptance speech from Washington, from the White House. Is all of this going to have a bearing on how this election unfolds, or how do you see it?
Yeah, I think so. First, Donald Trump should not be allowed to give from the White House. We have a very strict bifurcation between political office and governing bodies, and you should not do politics from that kind of office. Even congressmen have to go across the street to raise money because we have that strict bifurcation. It's an important principle to keep. As for the conventions, people are now asking, do we even need them? And I have to confess, I do mourn the loss. The conventions are part of the education of the electorate, and they're an important part, even when they don't actually make any decisions. Now they may turn into a minor TV show, and that, you know, I think that the power of them will be diminished. And with them, the power of the party will be diminished, because it's an opportunity for the entire party to express itself and not just a leader. And so I want to stick with the conventions, and we can have them normally. I hope we go back to that.
I'm actually with you on that, and we're going to be, you and Mark are going to be with me and our entire team for the week of the Democratic Convention, 3 hours every night, or as long as it goes, and the same thing for the Republican Convention. But Mark, how do you see this sort of shrinking convention in person, but more of a program online and on television? How do you see that affecting this election?
I think, Julie, the whole election is affected, beginning with the conventions. I agree totally with what David said. Politics is a contact sport. It's schmoozing. It's arm around the shoulder. It's getting together, whispering in each other's ears. There is none of that. It's getting to meet people from your same party, from different parts of the country, from different points of view. It's very, very important in that sense. The other thing that's been overlooked is conventions are a great showcase. Two American presidents in the past 40 years would not have been elected in all likelihood, but for their appearance at the convention. In 1976 at Kansas City, after he challenged President Ford in a bitter fight all the way to the end, in a gracious and generous off-the-cuff speech to that convention, Ronald Reagan endeared himself and set himself up for 1980s victory. And Barack Obama, I remember sitting there with David in Boston, at the Boston Garden, when he, as a Senate candidate from Illinois, brought down the House and electrified the nation with a speech which projected him into a major candidate for 2008. We never would have heard of Barack Obama but for that. So, I mean, I think that the conventions and the campaigns are changing. The idea of volunteering for kids to go door to door and canvassing, how are they going to do it? I mean, this is going to be a bizarre political election. Finally, I just say rallies are what conventions are. And if there's anybody who needs rallies psychologically and politically, it's Donald Trump. And the White House is not the best place to stage a rally.
Well, whatever the convention looks like, we're going to cover it from top to bottom. And those speeches, I guess, will come from living rooms and kitchens. But just quickly to both of you before we go, now that we know this pandemic isn't going away anytime soon, I just want a few words from both of you about how you're getting through this time. David, what do you tell yourself every morning when you get up and when you go to sleep at night?
Well, the hardest thing is not personal. It's a sense that our nation has gone through crises and has always pulled through them. And this time, I'm not sure we're pulling through them. And the thing that gives me hope is that somehow the African-American racial equity situation has become the central moral challenge, even in the midst of everything else. And somehow healing that divide is the healing of the nation. And it's just a spiritual sense I have that that out of this moment, we can come to a much better place, at least racially, if not in other ways.
Mark?
Well, as a loyal son of the University of Notre Dame, I rely on the words of a Protestant theologian, Reinhold Niebuhr, who said, God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. I just think it's genius. That and large samplings of Grater's ice cream have kept me sane.
Words to live by. Mark Shields, David Brooks, thank you both. As another difficult week comes to a close, we want to take the time to share the stories of five individuals who lost their lives to the coronavirus. Jennifer Robin Arnold was creative, fun, and a little outrageous. A friend called her a live wire. Jennifer was born into a family of dancers in New York City. In her 20s, she toured through Europe and South America as a professional dancer. She went on to help make costumes and work backstage on Broadway's Phantom of the Opera as a dresser for more than 30 years. A lover of Coney Island, Jennifer was 67 years old. After long days working as a registered nurse, Joshua Obrup often retreated to the happiest place on earth, Disneyland. His photographs of the park, posted on Instagram under the account Disneyland Panda, earned him more than 20,000 followers. As a child in Gardena, California, Josh begged his parents for a sister. He eventually got his wish in Jasmine. They were 8 years apart, but inseparable. Josh was 29 years old. 48-year-old Abraham Martin Vega of Texas will be remembered as a peacemaker, his daughter Corey said. At the age of 19, Abraham entered law enforcement and worked his way up to being elected Linn County Sheriff in 2016. Corey said that anyone who came in contact with her father instantly felt his affection, whether at Sunday church services or the grocery store. A husband, father, and grandfather, Abraham's family was his pride and joy. Cynthia Gutowski was known for gifting homemade treats all around town, from friends' houses to the doctor's office. That kindness extended to her lifelong career at Livonia, Michigan Public Schools as a dedicated aide to students with special needs. Her family says she was never able to sit still, even after her retirement in 2007. She loved boat rides and traveling. And with a recent trip to Alaska, she accomplished her lifetime goal of visiting all 50 states. Cynthia was 70 years old. Robert Kirkbride was gruff but compassionate, his daughter Martha said. He and his wife of 67 years, Patricia, worked to teach their three children the importance of church and community. Robert, or Bob, served in the Army, the Air Force, and as a police officer. He was a member of his local fire department for more than six decades, serving as chief for part of that time. Honored last year as the state of Vermont's longest-serving member of the Knights of Columbus, Bob was 93 years old. And thanks to these families for sharing these wonderful stories with us. And Of course, our hearts go out to all those who've lost loved ones in this pandemic. On the next episode of Beyond the Canvas, we hear from some bright stars and how chasing their dream has led to success. Gloria and Emilio Estefan talk about their partnership as musicians and as parents raising their family. That is this weekend only on PBS. Please check your local listings. But first, you can go online where there is more with Gloria Estefan, including a look at her new album, Paying Homage to Brazilian Music. That's on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. We'll be back on Monday with a look at what steps the Smithsonian Institution is taking as it begins to gradually welcome back visitors. I'm Judy Woodruff. Thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
When the world gets complicated, a lot goes through your mind. With Fidelity Wealth Management, a dedicated advisor can tailor advice and recommendations to your life. That's Fidelity Wealth Management.
Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. Financial services firm Raymond James. Women's Suffrage Centennial Commission. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.